So I'd like you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter number 25. Acts chapter number 25, and there's a chapter break between obviously 24 and 25. There's the reason I'm paid the big bucks to be able to determine that, by the way. But in spite of there being a chapter break, there is definitely no break for Paul. And the events of Acts 25 are going to pick right up where Acts 24 ended. Paul is imprisoned on false charges. He is waiting for a judgment to be declared. And as if that isn't enough, he was imprisoned by a man looking for a bribe. And because of this, his judgment was delayed. Paul remained imprisoned for now 2 years. And he seemingly suffered, as we spoke last time, an unjust delay. Yeah, we must remember that he was in the center of God's plan. Historically, we are told that Felix was removed from his position due to improperly handling a dispute between the Jews and the Gentiles. And now it's a man by the name of Porcius Festus, who is going to begin in Acts 24 a little bit later on. We'll see him standing before King Agrippa. It's said that Porcius Festus was likewise a very mean and cruel individual. During his reign, history tells us that his empire, or his territory, let's say it that way, was full of troubles as well as a variety of seditions. And so Acts 25 picks right back up where Acts 24 ends and resumes within the first few days of his ascension, Festus Porcius' ascension to the throne, having had Felix being replaced. So we pick it up in verse number 1, and I want us to begin by noting a meeting with the Jews. It's in the first 5 verses where the Bible says, "Now when Festus was come into the province after 3 days, he ascended from Caesarea to Jerusalem. Then the high priest and the chief of the Jews informed him against Paul and besought him and desired favor against him that he would send for him to Jerusalem, laying wait in the way to kill him. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept at Caesarea and that he himself would depart shortly thither. Let them therefore, said he, which among you are able, go down with me and accuse this man if there be any wickedness in him." We start with the meeting with the Jews. I want us to begin by noting in the first 3 verses a plea that is issued. 3 days after he arrives in the province, the Bible says in verse number 1 that he decided to leave Caesarea, and the Bible says that he ascended from Caesarea to Jerusalem. A little bit contrary to how we would talk if we were to say we're going to take a trip to Florida, we would say we're going to go down to Florida because we're going south. Here it is literally Caesarea is northwest of Jerusalem, and it says he's going to ascend to Jerusalem. Well, he's got to go southeast to be able to get there. The reason that he is ascending is just simply due to elevation. So he leaves the palace in Caesarea and he heads to Jerusalem. And as soon as he gets there, immediately here come these Jews. The chief priest, as well as the high priest, as well as the chief of the Jews, those who would be more prominent leaders within the Jewish community, they quickly informed him against Paul and besought him. The word "informed him against Paul" suggests that they came along and they provided him with all sorts of information, and they literally reported to him against Paul. Let me ask you this. Do you think that what they said was truthful? No. Do you think it contained some truth? Probably. Enough to at least make it believable. After all, Paul was in the temple. We do know that Paul was in Jerusalem. Those 2 facts at least would be true. What else they said beyond that, we are not necessarily sure of. But we can rest assured that the report that was given to him was not a report that was based in honesty. It was a report that would be tainted so that he would be able to get whatever it was that he wanted. The Bible speaks frequently of the importance of telling the truth. We find all throughout the New Testament commands where we are to put away lying and we are to lie not one to another. And the list goes on and on and on. Let me ask you this. Is shading the truth lying?
Yes.
Yes, it is. Isn't it interesting how quickly we are prone to shade the truth so that we can hopefully get what we wanted. It's amazing to me sometimes exactly what details are left out of a request. My daughters will be quick to tell you that if they ask permission to go do anything, there is a grilling session that takes place. Okay? Who, what, where, when, how, and to what extent. Okay, I taught English for too long. Who's there? What's going on? When are you going? How are you getting? How are you getting back? What time are you? I can tell you what time you're getting back, but how are you getting back? And this goes on and on and on. Why? Well, because children, not mine, but everyone else's children, would have a tendency to leave out some important details regarding who may or may not be there. You know, adults are the same way. Adults will sometimes be pulled into an office to discuss something with a boss, and they'll be sure that whatever report they give is one that's very favorable to their position. As a Christian, we need to be sure that what we do is honest always and in its entirety. Continues on, it said that they besought him and desired favor against him, that he would send for him to Jerusalem. Laying in the way to kill him. They issued this request. The word besought at the end of verse number 2 suggests that they repeatedly made a very strong request for something. And what they wanted was that Festus would summon him from Caesarea to Jerusalem. They desired favor against him. The word favor there is actually the word often translated grace. They wanted some sort of a gracious act to be done on their behalf, but it would be against Paul. What they really wanted, you're kind of new to the throne. Maybe he didn't know of some of the other stuff that had taken place. And they said, well, will you summons him from Caesarea to Jerusalem, and that way we can hear him here. Now, their entire plan, which of course they didn't reveal to Festus here, was that they would lay in wait, and their entire object was to go ahead and kill him, just as they had planned when Paul was released from the Antonia fortress. But keep in mind, how long had it been since he was released from the Antonia fortress? 2 years. Is it interesting to note that they are still consumed with killing this man? How much of a movement could he have possibly been creating, having been in prison for 2 years? That line of logic clearly isn't going to float. But it is very clear that they were so determined to kill him, and they were so filled with hatred, that even after 2 years, they still wanted him dead, and they were willing to once again include deception so that they could accomplish their agenda. Have you heard the phrase, somebody is blinded by hatred? That is exactly what we find here. You see a plea issued. Secondly, I'd like you to see a decision made, verses 4 and 5. But Festus answered that Paul should be kept at Caesarea, and that he himself would depart shortly thereafter. It almost sounds as though he didn't really give it a whole lot of thought. I do not know why he denied their request. For some reason he denied it. Perhaps he knew from Felix of some of the Jews' intent. We don't know, okay? But what I do know is this. Proverbs chapter 21 and verse 1 reminds us that the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. He turneth it as the rivers of water, whithersoever he will. God takes the heart of a king, the mind of a king, as pagan as they may very well be, and he is capable of directing that mind to accomplish exactly what he wants to accomplish. There's no president of the United States, and there's no king in any country of the land who is capable of going against what it is that God has ultimately decreed. As a Christian, sit back, rest in the Lord, and faithfully serve him, because God's got all the political scene of the entire world under control. The king's heart's in the hand of the Lord. It may very well be that Felix didn't want to be bothered by the paperwork. It may be that he didn't want to have to get the troops to be able to go 60-some miles back to Caesarea and then 60-some miles back. You know what? That's way too much of a hassle. I don't know. But regardless, Paul was in the hands of God, thankfully not in the hands of Jews who wanted to kill him, nor was he even in the hands of the Roman guards. God would not allow anything to happen to him unless he willed it. So then he told them in verse number 5, "Let them therefore," said he, "which among you are able, go down with me and accuse this man if there be any wickedness in me." He encouraged them, "Okay, I'm going to go down to Caesarea, and when I leave, you are more than welcome to come along with me and to make the journey." The word "able" here does not suggest that they are physically capable of making the journey. It would instead, "among you who are able," you who are politically powerful, now, those of you who have the authority to do so. There are lots of people who could have made the journey from Jerusalem to Caesarea. It was a very common journey that was made. Physically, there were many, yet they aren't going to do anything in regards to the case of Paul. And so those of you who have the political power and the political authority, you come down and you accuse them. And the word "accuse" suggests that you're going to go and you're going to formally bring the charges against Paul. And if there's anything that is behaviorally wrong or improper, then you guys bring the official charges against him. We move on and we see then the trial before Festus in verses 6 through 12. When he had tarried among them more than 10 days, he went down into Caesarea. The next day, sitting on the judgment seat, commanded Paul to be brought. Boy, nobody seems to get in a hurry back in the Bible days, nor do they today. "I'm going to be going to Caesarea shortly," says Festus. What's your definition of shortly? I'm thinking at least a day or two. 10 days? Good night. When are you going to Jerusalem? Okay. Get going already. I don't know if the religious leaders were becoming more and more anxious with all of it or not, but regardless, 10 days later, he finally goes. That leads us into then the point, a case heard. So he gets there. They all go down to Caesarea, and the next day, sitting on the judgment seat, commanded Paul to be brought. The judgment seat, we often describe the bema seat, the bema seat judgment of Christ, those types of things. That's the same word. And Paul uses that in 1 Corinthians 3 to bring a very vivid reminder and a vivid picture, because the Jews were very familiar with this very thing. It was a raised seat on which the ruler ultimately would end up sitting, and a judgment would be pronounced from this raised pedestal. We are reminded, and I'll not take the time to look at it, but we will all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. It's quite the day, and that's the time when Christians are going to be there. No unsaved person is going to be at that particular judgment. Well, he's seated there on this throne, and he commands Paul to be brought before him to have his case tried. And when he was come, verse 7, the Jews which came down from Jerusalem stood round about and laid many and grievous complaints against Paul, which they could not prove. The phrase that they stood round about literally means that they encircled him. And as they did so, the Bible says they brought many and grievous complaints against Paul. There was a multitude of charges that were brought. The word "grievous" suggests that they were weighty, they were heavy, they carried some legal weight to them. They were significant accusations. But isn't it interesting that everything that they said, they could not prove? The end of verse 7 says they simply could not prove the things that they accused him of. Why? Because they were false. Do you remember when we studied in Acts 24, the essence of a godly life, when in verse 16 Paul said, "Herein do I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward man"? I don't know about you, but I know that I've been accused of all sorts of things throughout my life. The worst part is that some of those accusations were true. Those are the things I really regret. "He said such and such." Yeah, I did. Oh, to live our lives in such a way that when people accuse us, the accusations are unfounded. They're unable to be proven. Often, we have perhaps a little bit of a higher view of ourselves than we should. It's very easy for us to sometimes think that maybe we are a little bit better than we truly are. If somebody comes and accuses you of lying, your testimony should be such that it would immediately be discarded by others, and it would be, if held up to a court of law, unable to be proven. But how tragic it is that we do not put the effort into always having a conscience that's void of offense before God and before man. And the result of that is that sometimes when people accuse us of things, they're actually right. It should not characterize us as believers. We mentioned the theme earlier on today, but having a faith that is without pretense, a faith that is unfeigned, faith that's without hypocrisy. When you have that kind of a faith, then you have a faith that is striving to be pure in God's sight as well as in man's sight. As we saw earlier in Acts 24, we'll reiterate it again here. Did the fact that Paul had, let me ask it a little differently. Did the fact that they were unable to prove the accusations eliminate them from delivering the accusations? No. If you really think that living a godly life means that you're going to be able to live a life that is accusation-free, you have another thing coming. You will still be accused. That's something you can't alter. It's not something you can change. But what you can change is being sure that what they accuse you of is false. There's no possible way that they are able to justify the claims that they are making. While he answered for himself, verse number 8, neither against the law of the Jews, neither against the temple, nor yet against Caesar, have I offended anything at all. You get an idea based on the topics that he covers in verse number 8, probably of the nature of their accusations. Paul had done something that broke the Jewish law. He had profaned the temple, and that was one of the earlier things, and even was guilty of creating a movement, a sedition that would revolt against Rome. Paul says all of these things are untrue. He was innocent, and he adamantly denied all the charges that were being declared against him. I remember many different times, and even here within the school at times, of being accused of knowing something that I really truly had no idea about. None. Even to the point where I had somebody tell me, "You are a liar." Now, it is hard for me to not get my sarcastic little self on and go down that path. I did not happen to that particular time, but boy, was I biting my tongue. Was I guilty of lying? Absolutely not. I simply did not know. And I went round and round and round and round with this person for about an hour being told, "You're a liar." No, actually I'm not. I had no idea that that took place. Yes, you did. No, I didn't. Yes, you did. You're a liar. How many times are we going to go around this same circle? You know, it felt like you're circling the same wagon every single day. It's like, you've had the same thing. Live your life in such a way that those kinds of accusations are unproven. And Paul said, you know what? All of this that they're saying I did no such thing. We move on into verses 9 through 12, and we see an appeal issued. But Festus, willing to do the Jews a pleasure, remember that statement from Felix at the end of chapter 24? Felix was willing to do the Jews a pleasure and he left Paul bound for 2 years. Festus was willing to do the Jews a pleasure. Do you know that both of these men had the potential to simply dismiss the case and throw it out? But they wanted to do what was politically right for them. If they had been governed by ethics and been governed by justice and the need to do what was right, I wonder when this trial would have actually stopped. But they were instead guilty of, I really want the favor of the Jews. I really want to be liked by people. We talked about this as well. What identifies you in one of the banners? Are you identified by popularity? Meaning I am what people think of me. Many people strive to be popular. Strive to be well-liked by everybody. You can't be well-liked by everybody. It's not going to happen. Live a life that pleases the Lord and let the chips fall where they may. Don't strive to create enemies, but live a life that's pleasing to the Lord. And you know what? Those who don't want to live a life pleasing to the Lord aren't going to like you. It is what it is. But let me point out to you, because that sounds rather heartless, and I understand that, there are times when the people who aren't going to like you are awfully near and dear to you. And it's hard at that point in time. And here was a man who likewise is governed by popularity and is governed by what everybody's going to think. Well, he said, "Wilt thou go up to Jerusalem and there be judged of these things before me?" The word "wilt" there suggests that it's a wish of, the word "willing" in verse 9 at the first part of it and the word "wilt," those are the same two words, but they both express a little bit of a different idea. The first one, "willing," suggests a wish of resolve. In other words, Festus determined that he would do the Jews a pleasure. Okay? It's a wish of resolve. I wish to eat. Okay? I will resolve myself to eat lunch here in a little bit. Then it's the second one, "wilt," here is a wish of desire. Wish, do you wish to go to Jerusalem? Do you have the desire to return to Jerusalem where you would be able to now be tried before them? Paul said in verse 10, "I stand at Caesar's judgment seat, where I ought to be judged. To the Jews have I done no wrong, as thou very well knowest." Now, he was not literally standing before Caesar. He's standing before Festus in Herod's palace at Caesarea. But he is appointed ultimately by the Roman emperor. He is a judge of a lower court. Therefore, he is representative of Caesar's seat. Paul says, "I stand here, I have done no wrong to the Jews," and it's interesting that he says, "and you know that." You know it. You know the accusations are untrue. You know there's no legitimate basis for the accusations. You know this. "For if I be an offender, or have committed anything worthy of death, I refuse not to die. I am willing to accept the punishment if I did what was wrong. But if there be none of these things whereof they accuse me, no man may deliver me unto them. I appeal unto Caesar." Here's what Paul says. "I am standing here where I ought to be judged. I'm innocent, and you know that I'm innocent. If I weren't innocent and had a punishment coming, I would gladly take that punishment. But the fact that I am innocent suggests that I should be freed from this. There's absolutely no possible way that you are going to deliver me to the hands of the Jews. Paul knew that if he were to do that, it would be certain death. There's no doubt about it. They weren't looking for justice. They were looking to execute him, and they were trying to do whatever means necessary. And so Paul said, you know what? I appeal to Caesar. I take and my case to the highest court in the land. In a day when individuals are often selfishly demanding their rights, we do need to establish a biblical understanding of our rights. People go around today and they say, well, I have a right to do certain things. Well, some of those things you really don't have a right to do. Freedom, as I've said many times, is not the absence of law or absence of restraint. Most people think freedom means that I get to go do whatever I want to do. It's an absence of restraint. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. Not sure if any of you have found that life yet. I have not. Decided I'd buy a house, and the bank told me what I was going to pay them, when I was going to pay it, and how long I was going to pay it. I didn't care for that idea. But I have yet to be able to call the bank and say, you know, I'd really like to not make this month's payment, and I'd prefer to go ahead and schedule it on this day, next month, and I'd like to do half. Doesn't work that way. The water company, they say, you're going to pay this bill because you use this much money, and if you don't pay this bill, we're going to turn your water off. Well, that's not very nice. I want to be able to go do what I want to do. I've got a boss who tells me when I'm going to come to work. He has certain expectations of what I'm going to get done. Some of the tasks I don't mind doing. Some of the tasks I'd rather not do, but he says this is what you're going to do. Say, well, you're at the church, you don't have a boss. Really? I got a whole bunch of them sitting right in front of me. Okay? Do this, do that, do this. That's one thing. But the other side of it is this. If I don't fulfill my obligations here, what happens? You exercise your authority and say bye-bye. Or you should. Okay? So am I independent of bosses here? No, I answer to the church. Do I have authority over them? Yes. But does that mean it's independent of authority? No. Okay? On and on and on and on the list can go. Freedom is not the absence of restraint. Freedom operates within certain parameters. Okay, so now when we talk about our rights, we're not talking about these selfish rights that people think they have. We're talking about the legal rights that have been given to us by our Constitution. Amen. Our founding fathers and our nation in particular, God granted them, I believe, the wisdom to form a constitution, and it says this is how our land is to be governed. When the three branches of government properly perform their responsibilities, then all of the laws that are created within our nation are not to be in conflict with the Constitution. Ideally. Unfortunately, we have, through the years, gotten away from all of this. Our Constitution was written to be able to protect the citizens against a tyrannical government. Incidentally, let me point out, not just someone with whom you disagree. There's a whole lot of cry out there that our president is like Adolf Hitler. Study history, folks. It's nowhere near. Okay? It's nowhere near. You disagree with somebody, therefore they're equivalent to the worst person that you can possibly think of. Absolutely not. You can disagree with them, but it does not mean that you can draw those kinds of conclusions. And like it or not, he is the President of the United States of America. He is an authority under which we are to be subject and one for whom we are to pray. How well are you doing? Now, that was free. It's not even in my notes. To get back to my notes, where it talks about the rights that we have within our Constitution afford us legal rights. Is it okay for a Christian to exercise his legal rights? Yes, it is. Well, the Bible says that you're to be meek. be a doormat that everybody walks on and wipes their feet off on. No, that's not the case. You want to sue me for my house? Okay, go ahead. Here you go. What else would you like to sue me for? No, we have certain legal rights, and courts are designed that way. There's nothing wrong with a Christian exercising his legal right. Paul, as a citizen of Rome, had a legal right to a fair trial. He has yet to be granted one. For him to go back to Jerusalem would certainly not create a fair trial. And so he says, I go to Caesar. Forget you guys, I appeal. Was he right in doing so? Absolutely. Okay? Is it okay for you to exercise your rights within the legal system? Yes. Are you to sue individual members within a local church? No. Okay? It's another issue. Okay? It can be challenging navigating through all of that stuff. And by the way, I do believe that's within a local church. Okay? Because anybody can claim, well, I'm a Christian, therefore you can't take me to court. Well, not necessarily. There are certain issues here where there are legal cases, okay? And certain crimes and so forth. It's not wrong to press charges, things like that. This is a matter of the legal thing. And so God doesn't expect us to park our brains and lay down like a doormat either. So he says, I appeal to Caesar. So then Festus, verse 12, when he had conferred with the council, this is not the Jewish Sanhedrin, this would be his own legal council, answered, hast thou appealed unto Caesar? Unto Caesar shalt thou go. I don't know if he gave him any chance to answer. Okay? Every parent's done that. Fine, you want to do this? Then go do it. There was no answer. Wait, I don't want to do that. Okay? Do you appeal to Caesar? Then unto Caesar you're going to go. And I think that's how it phrased. Maybe Paul had an opportunity to nod his head, but regardless, that's what he said. Moves us into a much larger point that obviously we'll not cover today. And when you see the references, you can breathe a sigh of relief. The trial before Agrippa, which consumes the rest of chapter 25 and all of chapter 26. We would be here for a very long time to go through all of that. But I do want us to begin by noting a dilemma explained. Verses 13 through 21. After certain days, King Agrippa and Bernice came unto Caesarea to salute Festus. King Agrippa came with his sister Bernice. This is not his wife. This would be Agrippa II, who would be the son of Agrippa I. Go figure that. But his father died when he was actually 17 years old. And he was considered too young to assume the government of Judea, so he was placed by Claudius under the care of a procurator, basically kind of like a tutor type thing. Church historians actually indicate that he would often embrace the cause of the Jews whenever he could. 8 years later, AD 52, the age of 25, he was given a territory over which he could reign. A little bit later on, his territory was expanded by Nero and it included some additional land. He was furthermore brother-in-law to Felix. Well, he and Bernice made their way to the city of Caesarea to greet Festus. And as he gets there, when they had been there many days, again, while they're all having a good time, Paul is still in prison. He said, he declared Paul's cause unto the king, saying, there's a certain man left in bonds by Felix. There's a guy I inherited when I came. There's a problem that I got as soon as I occupied the throne, about whom, when I was at Jerusalem, the chief priests and the elders of the Jews informed me, desiring to have judgment against him. I was just simply recounting things. And from what I can tell in this section, it's fairly factual in comparison to what it is that he would know. Keep in mind, he didn't know all of the events that Felix necessarily knew. Felix knew more from Claudius Lysias and the chief guard there in the Antonia fortress and all of the beating. Festus probably did not know all of that. But so I was in Jerusalem, he says to Agrippa, I was there, and the elders of the Jews informed me, and they wanted judgment against him. They conveyed this formal report, they brought the charges, and they were seeking a legal punishment for him. To whom I answered, it is not the matter of the Romans to deliver any man to die before that he which is accused have the accusers face to face and have license to answer for himself concerning the crime laid against him. It is not customary, says Festus, that a citizen of Rome would be put to death until he has had a fair trial, till he has had opportunity for the accusers to meet face to face and deliver the charges, as well as the opportunity, the word license is actually used, but the opportunity to be able to defend himself. Therefore, when they were come hither, when they came to Caesarea, without any delay on the morrow, I sat on the judgment seat and commanded the man to be brought forth. I sat down immediately and commanded him to be brought forth. I didn't delay anything, says Festus. Everything has been followed by the proper legal protocol to this point. Against whom, when the accusers stood up, they brought none accusation of such things as I supposed. Isn't this interesting? They didn't bring the actual accusations that he was expecting when they got there to Caesarea. We're not told exactly what they said to Agrippa, but whatever it was, he did not see it coming. But they had certain questions against him of their own superstition and of one Jesus, which was dead, whom Paul affirmed to be alive. This is an unsaved man speaking. Festus looks at this and says, man, look, Agrippa, I don't know what to do. I didn't expect to hear the charges that I heard. When they got there and they started everything, they started talking about somebody named Jesus. Aren't you thankful for what he's done, by the way, for your life? They started talking about somebody named Jesus, and they said he's dead. Paul says he's alive. The word affirmed, by the way, means that he stated something with absolute confidence. Was there any doubt in Paul's mind about whether or not Jesus Christ was alive? Nope. Shouldn't be in yours either. If there is, you're not saved. So he says, because I doubted of such manner of questions, I was at a loss. I was confused. I had no idea what to do. Okay? It's like a counseling session. When you're sitting in a counseling session, you're listening to two people talking, and you think, man, I have no idea what to do. At some point in time, they are going to stop talking. And they're going to look to me for some sort of wise answer. And I'm at a loss. I'm sitting here on the judgment seat, and Agrippa, I had no idea what to say. So, I asked him whether he would go to Jerusalem and there be judged of these matters. I don't think that Agrippa was intentionally trying to get rid of Paul or get him executed. I think to him this was a matter of their own religion. It was a matter that would be dealt with within their own Jewish system of court. And from a legal perspective, it would seem very fitting. Man, look, you got your lawnmower stolen and you're trying to go to the Supreme Court? Okay? I mean, go to Morganton. Deal with it there. But we're already up to some district, and now he's talking to the Supreme Court. I mean, from a legal perspective, what in the world is he going all the way up there for? But when Paul had appealed to be reserved under the hearing of Augustus, I commanded him to be kept till I might send him to Caesar. I didn't have any other choice. He said, I appeal to Caesar, so he's got to go to Caesar. So I have him in prison now, waiting for this time for me to be able to send him to Caesar. Do you think Festus was in quite the dilemma? He was. Let me ask you this. Could his dilemma have been solved if he had just stuck with justice? and done what was right and not been concerned with the opinion of people? A lot of it certainly could have been solved. How many dilemmas in your own life could have been solved if you had just simply done what was right?
Amen.
It would eliminate a lot of dilemmas. Would eliminate a lot of pickles that we find ourselves in. We move on and we see a case heard that will begin here in chapter 25 and will continue all the way through the end of chapter 26. And we'll start by focusing those in the remainder of chapter 25 with a problem encountered. Then Agrippa, verse 22, said unto Festus, I would also hear the man myself. I desire to hear this myself. And he said, tomorrow, said he, thou shalt hear him. Be careful what you wish for, you might get it. Agrippa said, you know what, I want to hear him. He said, all right, good, tomorrow. And on the morrow, when Agrippa was come, and Bernice with great pomp, and was entered into the place of hearing, it's a big show. And he gets there with the chief captains and the principal men of the city, the influential people. At Festus' commandment, Paul was brought forth. And Festus said, almost as though this whole conversation didn't take place, now he's going to say this in front of everybody, King Agrippa, and all men which are here present with us, ye see this man about whom all the multitude of the Jews have dealt with me, both at Jerusalem and also here, crying that he ought not to live any longer. You guys are witnesses of this reality that even while I was in Jerusalem and now here in Caesarea, they want Paul dead. But when I found that he had committed nothing worthy of death and that he himself hath appealed to Augustus, I have determined to send him, but of whom I have no certain thing to write unto my Lord. Wherefore I have brought him forth before you, and especially before thee, O King Agrippa, that after examination had I might have somewhat to write, for it seemeth to me unreasonable to send a prisoner, and not withal to signify the crimes laid against him. You see his dilemma. There would be a letter that would accompany the prisoner. The letter would be read to Julius or to Caesar Augustus that would say, all right, or to Caesar, rather. The letter would be read. It says, here are the nature of the charges. Festus says, Agrippa, I've got a problem. I've got nothing to write. Once again, what a testimony of Paul. For me, there's probably not enough paper on that scroll. Okay, the list goes on and on and on. You can stop writing at any point in time, sir. Okay, but not for Paul. I don't have anything to write. And so I brought him to you, Agrippa, hoping that after you've had this case and you've heard him, that I would at least have a charge that I could write down that would have some sort of legal weight. Because it seems, as he says in verse 27, unreasonable to send a prisoner. It's contrary to reason. It's foolishness to send a prisoner when we have no reason to even have him imprisoned. So now, he'll stand before Agrippa. Paul done anything wrong? No. Paul is being persecuted for righteousness' sake. It's a topic that Peter addresses, and it's one that I want to read, and then we'll just simply close our message here this morning. Peter said this in 1 Peter 2 and verse 19, this is thankworthy. This is something that is worthy of thanks. Worthy of praise. If a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully, that's something to rejoice in. It's something to thank God for. I don't know about you, but I'd struggle to thank God for that. I'd struggle to find that as being something worthy of my praise or worthy of my thanks. Peter goes on and he ensures them that if this is the case, be sure that you're being persecuted for righteousness' sake. I've seen a lot of Christians who, in a sincere desire to protest something, do things that are illegal. And then they suffer the consequences of doing something illegal. Perhaps it's an arrest. And then it's all over Facebook that so-and-so is being persecuted for Jesus' sake. No, so-and-so is being persecuted. He's being arrested because he broke the law. Unfortunately, he had a Jesus banner, and therefore it negates the same message that you and I try to declare. There's no glory in that. You're not being persecuted for righteousness' sake. You're being persecuted because you deserved it. Don't rejoice in that. But if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully, this, something to be thankful for. Whew. I don't understand it. What a challenge. You and I have no idea the days that are ahead for us as believers. We may very well find where this time becomes very real to us. And these types of cases and things are very challenging. Is it okay to exercise our legal rights? Absolutely it is. But let's strive day in and day out to have a conscience where it's, as Paul said earlier, void of offense. You live your life tomorrow at work in such a way that nobody can point to any accusation. That's a challenge in and of itself. To me, that's a whole lot more realistic application and challenge than when you stand in a court of law for your faith. Because right now, that's probably not going to happen tomorrow. But I can assure you, you're going to come across someone who's difficult tomorrow. And it's probably just going to be yourself. All right? You don't have to look too far. You're going to be challenged. Live a godly life. Determine to have a conscience that's pure before God. As musicians come,